Que de la costa, Navidad de sole.
Hi, I'm America Ferrera, and I am Anna Garcia in this movie, Real Women Have Curves.
I'm Lupe Ontiveros, and I play Carmen, Anna's mother, in the film. Oh, and by the way, Patricia Cardoso sends her wishes to you. She's the director of the film. And today is a very important day. She's about to deliver her baby. So we wish her well.
Hi, Anna. Something happened to her mom.
What happened?
I don't know. Come and talk to her.
Stella, I always have to do it. You go.
She wants you, not me.
I first heard about it through, you know, general auditioning. I had a manager and agent. They called me and said, they're casting for this part. And I went in and I auditioned for it. So I didn't really know anybody connected to it. It was just kind of, you know, went in and did it. Kept my fingers crossed.
Who is it?
It's Anna.
I mean, if I come closer.
I did the play. I did the play about 8, 9 years ago. Actually, I met Josefina, gosh, about 15, maybe 17 years ago, before she went to New York. She was on her way to the university over there. And I had heard about the play. She had performed it various parts, New York. They've done it all over the place. And she asked me, why don't we do it? Why don't we do it in San Diego? Sure, she played my daughter. She played Anna. Then later we performed it in Tucson. But the film and the play are two worlds apart.
Today's my last day of high
school. The film takes us more into the interaction of the family, Anna's environment, and the relationship she has with her grandfather and her father, whereas the play was the factory. It tended to be rather superficial in covering certain subject matters that are part of the outlining part of this, which is the relationship between the mother and the daughter, the sister, the sweatshop, the women. But the film actually goes into the third dimensional part of each character. We have a father, we finally see a father. There was never mention of a grandfather,
there's
cousins.
That part right there, I had to keep walking faster. I did so much walking in this movie, my God. I just walked, and they called me back for reshoots, and I was like, what are we reshooting? Nothing, they just needed more scenes of me walking. So I spent like the whole day just walking up and down the streets in Boyle Heights. It was fun. I thought it was a really amazing way for the cinematographer, Jim Deneau, to make Boyle Heights look like a beautiful place. I mean, look at this.
It's
look
very
at the
Bohemian.
Colors. You feel a sense of culture there. You know, you look at the murals on the wall. There's, you know, there's on Cesare Chavez, the boulevard, there's a huge mural of Cesare Chavez. And just when they're in the truck or when she's on the bus, you just see her submerged in this cultural place, you know? And then, yeah, she does a lot of walking. And I think that the importance of showing these scenes of her walking, then getting on a bus, then getting on another bus, and then walking some more, it just helps the audience get into that feeling of what she must go through every single morning just to get to school, you know? And her own mom doesn't even want her to be doing it. So what type of girl is she to be so motivated to wake herself up and take 3 buses to get to a school, you know, where some kids don't even want to get out of bed to go to school? You know, I knew I lived a block away from my high school. I never wanted to get up and go. So
there was a curiosity here. There was a comment made in one of the reviews. The question was, who or what is Anna's support system? Does she have any friends? Remember how many mm-hmm. they were asking? Well, she's got this young man there as a friend. Support system as they come with the teacher. At home, she's got her sister. She's got her father. She's got grandfather. Mother may not be the best choice, but it's still there. But, you know, I think they were asking, where are the other girls? And do you party? Do you have a social life? Huh?
You I don't think so. This was our first day of filming, actually, right here in the classrooms. This was the very first day of me filming. You were the best. And it was, like, the most nerve-wracking day. You know, you just have to get that first shot over with. And for me, it was, like, the whole day, working with George and the boyfriend and everything. And it was hard. It was tough. But that was, it's funny that that was, you know, the first thing we filmed, because I didn't, my relationship with the family wasn't yet established, so I just kind of winged, you know, the relationship with the teacher and with the kids in school. But you see that, and I think it's pretty accurate that a girl like her, who obviously has, you know, a destination, any interaction with anything else would make her mind stray from that destination. And I think she's so set on getting to where she's going that she doesn't care about partying or care about, you know, I knew that when I, you know, when I was in high school and I knew I wanted to be an actor, I didn't have, like, huge groups of friends. I didn't go partying because I knew what I wanted and I was so intent on doing that. And I think it's pretty accurate that she doesn't have, like, you know, her clique and her girlfriends. I don't think she's a girlfriend type of girl, you know? I think she's a lot more independent than that.
Andale, apúrate.
Tommy.
Felicidades! Felicidades, Anita.
In my case, the experience of just being in film for 20-something years, you set aside everything from the play. It has no relationship. My mind never saw the play, if you might say that. I was a totally different woman. And I had a totally different daughter. And my purpose was entirely different. And so rehearsal-wise, you know, Patricia is not one to rehearse intensely, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was more on a camera blocking situation because we pretty well had it down. It was not, I hate to say this, but it was as real as it is, as you're seeing it, and I think that's the commentary, is that we really didn't push towards anything. It just came out of us.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds arrogant to have to say that, but I think, you know, every Jorge the father is a seasoned actor. Grandpa's right there. He's a seasoned actor from Mexico. Ingrid has done film before. I think our newcomer was the only one that, but she could feel comfortable. That could be made to feel, hey, it's home.
Yeah, it just kind of felt natural, like everybody else was doing some, you know, they were just into it. They were just doing it. It's hard to stop it and say, you know what, I want to rehearse this before we go. When it's there, you know, there's no need to rehearse it. If it's going, you know, the river's flowing, just go with it.
I think if Patricia would have seen that it wasn't going the direction she wanted, she would have stopped it. But she gave us a lot of leeway. Just a lot of liberty. And that I think it's admirable for a director, a first-time director. Female, you know what I'm saying? Male or female.
Buenas tardes, señor. Señora. Soy Liz Guzmán. Fui el maestro.
George impressed me a great deal with his performance in this film. I've worked with George before in another film. But he was very, very low-key. I mean, you almost do not see George Lopez from the George Lopez Show.
Mm-mm.
You don't have the inkling that he's a comedian of any sort. He's just a great guy that cares.
Yeah, it was weird to work with him because I had expected one thing. You know, you think that comedians are jokesters all the time or they'll come on the set and pull pranks or whatever. And, you know, he's great. We had fun, but he's very, you know, he takes his work very seriously. And I had worked with him. This is where the first time I met him, and then I went to go see his stand-up. And he was just a whole different person on stage. So that was amazing for me to see, you know, that he him go from comedian to actor, because they are two very, very different mediums, you know, being on stage and being in front of a camera. I had one project right before Real Women Have Curves, and it was a Disney movie, and I had a lot of leeway for mistakes. You know, that was my transition piece to kind of get used to what it's like to be in front of a camera rather than on stage. And then once I got here, I really had to put that to work. You know, a lot of the work had to be very subtle, and it couldn't be larger than life, you know, musical stage acting. So that was a challenge for me.
I don't recall. I think the scene was not in the original script. I'm not sure. But I remember that because Jorge and I spoke Spanish, I insisted on a lot of stuff being in Spanish because it drew us closer to who we were and what our roots were. And people just naturally communicate better in their own proper language, their original language. And we wrote this scene. Jorge, a Mexican, you know, we started off saying lines and then we kept going from there. And he actually wrote them down and said, okay, let's shoot it. I was very grateful for that because I knew if I was going to be involved in this film, I had to do it my way, the way I saw this woman. And she was not a clown. She was not a witch. She was not a cruel, evil individual. She just had her own reasons for the way she is. And they have very strong cultural and religious origins.
Like mom, okay?
Whatever you say.
El becerro cuartelzón no ha comido ni ha mamado. El becerro cuartelzón no ha comido ni ha mamado. La vaca lo abandonó por seguir al toro bravo. En la puerta del potrero el pobrecito está bramando. En la puerta del potrero el pobrecito está bramando.
So this is what you're talking, another one, you know, we're in the car, yes, but the camera shots of you see, you know, the people in the street. And
hey,
and none of this is staged. This is, see, look at that mural with, I mean, that's just filled with culture. Like, we didn't just ask people, please stand here. You know, we just took a camera and documented life in, the, you know, in Boyle Heights.
There was a comment also made recently that New York, Greenwich Village, has, it was so bohemian before. And now it's changed a lot. A lot of places are, very few places are left like this, where real life is there. And it's, you know, it's expressive of what its cultures are that surround it. And like in this case, the sweatshops here, there's a garage. This is, you know, for the workforce of this class of people.
We really made the garage, the sweatshop home. This was our home for how many weeks? For the first probably 3 weeks of shooting, every day, you know, we spent 10, 12 hours in the sweatshop. It was home to us for this film. And also, Lupe, tell them what you did.
Well, I tend to look into my roots, my indigenous roots, for all the help you can get. And the first day of filming at the sweatshop, we had a group of Aztec dancers come in and give us a ritual blessing.
They blessed the factory and us.
Yes, individually. And ironically, they blessed Patricia. She got pregnant. Josefina, she got pregnant.
Jim Deneau, his wife got pregnant.
So, you know, it was all, and we started doing this at Sundance because I'm a great believer that the energy that we transmit to one another, if it's on the right key, if it's that energy, that force will only make it greater. And nobody questioned it. You know, everybody was very, the producer was very much in tune with it.
So, yeah, there was, so I guess what that did was just another thing that added to the energy in that room, because so much had to go on in that factory. The relationships between the women had to be right for you to care about them. You know, the scene that we will come to later where there just has to be a certain dynamic. So I thought it made perfect sense to bless that area, you know, kind of a feng shui type thing in our, you know, just create a positive energy.
A lot of my feeling for the sweatshop and the reason I felt so comfortable was because I come from a factory my mother had. She had a tortilla factory and she had restaurants back in Texas, El Paso. And these were the kind of people that used to come to work for her.
Mm-hmm.
And I grew up around them. So I was very comfortable in creating this atmosphere, although these ladies are not sweatshop, you know, experienced, but nevertheless, to create the camaraderie, the feeling of home, familia, and that we both have to sweat in this shop together. You know what I'm saying? Nobody's above anybody else. And I think you pick up on that.
No, I'm just helping out my sister until I find a better job.
Oh, me too. I'm just working here until I win the lottery.
right there with that scene is that with they're talking about her attitude, you know? They don't like her attitude, and it's hotsy-totsy. Is it because she's 17? Because she's an American born? She's in high school? And these women, you know what I'm saying is, unless you're around working class people, do you know, can you hear their rhythms and understand how they're thinking? You know what I'm saying? It's a whole pattern of understanding psychologically, socially.
Yeah, this was such an uncomfortable scene to shoot. Because when it's almost like being the new kid in class. You know, you walk in and everybody has their inside jokes, their cliques, their groups. And you don't know, you know, you're not part of the in crowd. You know, you don't know how they're going to receive you. You don't, and then much less for her, she's an 18-year-old girl and these women are, you know, middle-aged women who won't understand.
Have nothing in common with her.
Have nothing in common with her. Don't understand where she wants to go in her life. And she's just hating it. And her mother here, milking it for, like, you know, welcome to our place.
She's very proud. See, she's very proud as I give her her scissors. I mean, this is the beginning of your life, she wants, she's saying. You know, these scissors are your pride and joy in here. And she means that. She's happy as a lark.
When Anna, you know, I always picture when Anna comes in, she's just in pure disgust at this. Like, how could these women, how could they submit themselves to this? Like, they're settling for this. This is going to be the rest of their lives, making dresses at less than minimum wage for Macy's. You know, how could you make this your life? And this is a very generational conflict. She doesn't get it. She doesn't understand where they're coming from because her life, she's been raised, you know, through education to think that you can go beyond that. You should go beyond that. And if you don't, then you're just plain ignorant, you know? So she doesn't find any dignity in it to begin with. That's what. But I think throughout the scenes, you see by the end of the movie that she did realize that there's a sense of pride there. That she realized, you know, maybe there's more to these women than what I see or what middle America sees in them. And I think that's a huge issue is to these people, they find pride and dignity in this work. To middle America, living in their suburban homes with two Mercedes-Benz and a dog in the backyard, you know, they see these women as a disgrace. Why aren't you doing better? Why didn't you go to college? You see, they don't see that the other side to that generational and cultural conflict.
You should be working. El Dorado Ortiz is secretly in love with Rosalie.
To a sweatshop, it's survival. It's this is your home. You lose this job, like the girl's gonna go off to get married in Mexico, and everybody's broken and torn apart, and she's torn apart because she's got to separate. And this is the end to the means of surviving in this country. In the play, they used to be undocumented. Here, you'll never deal with the issue of them because they would run, and even the mother would run, forget she was documented. I mean, that was the comical part about it, but they never once mention it here in the film, but you never know if these ladies are done. Makes all the difference in the world how you also feel. But this is a sweatshop. Some of the other sweatshops in L.A. are worse than this. I mean, they're a humongous factory. This is the second sweatshop that I work in film. El Norte was the first one. And the immigration came in and dragged everybody around.
This is my mom.
Is this your daughter?
Sí, San Gordita, my daughter.
In this scene, the mother sits and talks to the daughter and tells her, you know, I can't take any more of this. I can't live this way. She's given her life, her whole life, to dressmaking. And probably three quarters of it to a sweatshop. She can't see. Her back hurts. She's got arthritis. There's no end to it. And they don't even think about dignity anymore. It's not about that. It's just putting out and having these dresses finished when we have to so we can get paid and go home. That's it.
And I think the fact that Anna, you know, how hard her mother's worked and Anna finds no pride or dignity or, you know, she doesn't have any pity for her mom is like a spit in the face for the mom, you know? Like, look at how I've worked my entire life to give you, you know, food and to give you clothes on your back in a house and you find, you know, it's a disgrace to you. And I think what Anna wants is she looks at her mom and she looks at her mother's given her entire life for minimum wage, you know, always living just to survive. You know, she's not working for a better quality of life. She's just working for survival. And Anna looks at her mom and says, I don't want this for me. I don't want this life. And if anything, you know, and the mother sees it not as like, yes, I want my daughter to have a better life. She sees it as betrayal almost. How dare you think that what I can give you isn't good enough for you? It's almost like
but that's the only thing she can give her.
Yeah.
Is her own skill that she learned when she was 13.
But she's also very, very close-minded, the mother. You know, rather than saying, my daughter will go off, get educated, get a better job, and then maybe bring me out of this crap hole. Or maybe my daughter will never have to live the rest of her life, you know, with arthritic hands and be 50-some years old and not have any money saved away. Rather than thinking that way, she thinks, you know, she's a traitor to our culture and to our craft.
Ay, qué lindo. Mírate en el espejo.
I remember as a young kid also asking the question to my mother, because the San Antonio statue was, the baby wasn't there. And I said, why is the baby not there? And she had a promise of some sort that she had asked for. I don't know that it necessarily was a baby, but some people take the baby away because they want to get married. And in this case, it's getting married. It's for Stella. Take the kid away from it. And he'll grant you your wishes, but who knows if it worked or not. I don't know.
I love the scene where the mom, where Carmen is with her birds, because just that
little
thing with the birds, it makes her more human. Because I think Lupe's completely right. If you were not to see those little moments where she wasn't such a cruel, you know, person, you'd think it's not even real. It's not even reality. But the reality of it is that she is a person and she is tender. You know, she loves her birds. She feeds her birds, you know.
This is my favorite scene with Grandpa and Dad and Anna. This man, this grandpa, I understand, has quite a film trajectory from Mexico. And he's been around some of the best films of the golden era of Mexico. And so with little that he had to say, he said it all. And this particular scene, it is so beautiful when she is so loving to Grandpa. You'll find your treasure. I hope you find your treasure. He comes back to her and says, I've already found my treasure. My treasure is you. Now you go find your treasure.
Mm. It's like the only person in the house who does support her. You know,
he adores her. Well, he goes out with her to go to the movies.
Or like, you know, you think he's an innocent old man. He's the one helping Anna, you know, get up and get out. But I also think that, you know, because Anna at times can be a very, you know, bratty person too. And you think, how rude. Like, how dare she talk to her mom like that? Does she talk to all grown-ups like that? You know, that's what goes through grown-ups' minds. But then you see her here. No, it's not with every grown-up. Here's a man who, you know, her grandpa who trusts her and loves her and supports her. And she doesn't have to be bratty with him. It's just with her mom who gives her no breathing space at all. It's like she walks one step. Walk right. Hurry up. Come on, lose weight. You know, like it's like every step she takes, her mom is there criticizing. So
now, I've often wondered why she looks at the child because she's crying.
She's annoyed. She's annoyed with the kid.
Oh, she's annoyed with the kid. Okay.
I've ridden the buses before, and you want nothing. I mean, there's nothing worse than having a crying kid on a damn bus.
No, I think the airplanes is where it's
for. Oh, the boyfriend. The one person who.
Of course it is. I don't lie on applications, except about my weight.
You know, if it hadn't been for George and this, well, the teacher, she never would have taken the action she did. My feeling is that she would have just gone back and been angry.
Because you see, in the first scene,
she. Life being angry that she never.
Yeah.
You know, did anything that. You know, you're 17, you feel you can do just about anything.
Well, you even see, like, in the first scene where she's like, you know what, Mr. Guzman, don't waste your time. You know, like, she's basically, she's accepted her destiny. My destiny is to work in a sweatshop, a minimum wage for the rest of my life. You're better off helping somebody else, you know? That's what her reaction. And then all it takes is one teacher to encourage her, and look at her. Now she's willing to do whatever it takes to get there. And I think that's, my teachers, I had a couple teachers who inspired me.
Something really that I noticed, and it kind of bothered me, because I felt for those students that are from this part of the world to go to school in Beverly Hills. Can you imagine what that's like? Worlds, universes apart. They don't speak the same language, you might say. They speak English, but it doesn't mean they're communicating in the same
language. Well, I've gone to public schools my whole life, and in public schools, you know, kids get bused in from East LA out to the valley by the hundreds. And yes, they're going to school in a suburban area.
But it doesn't seem that there's that many there. You seem to be the only one in that school.
Well, you don't even see that many kids, but I went to suburban public schools, and you get kids who are, inheriting billions of dollars from their parents, and then you have kids who have nothing, and they're all in the same area, and that's a very big reality. And it's almost like when you enter that school, when you enter that realm, everybody leaves everything else on the outside, because school is the one, like, equalizer. We're like, okay, we're all here and we're all the same. Once you start talking about cars and who gets this when they turn 16 and what college are you going to, you know, it divides people, because not everyone has the same thing.
This is the scene that everybody...
This is my favorite scene in the whole movie. We had to shoot it so many times because I couldn't stop laughing. It's my favorite. It's the one time you see the entire family together. The cousins in the background, the grandpa. I love the scene. This is my favorite scene.
See, they watch religiously these soap operas, you know.
Carmen seems so human here. That's what I love
about it. Oh, the Jorge. It was Jorge's idea. Jorge is an old friend. You know, we've been around so long. But when he starts rubbing my back and his hand goes down, see, he told me, I'm going to pull my hand down. And you hit me. And I just went with it. I knew what he meant. And it was perfect. Because here the audience chuckles, you know, because they know what it's about. And Jorge's always been, he's been around forever. Jorge Cervera Jr. He's had these horrific roles. Ugly stereotypes. Beast-like, greasy Mexican, dirty soldier, criminal. But this one, he's been totally different. They asked me who I wanted as a husband, and I said Jorge Cervera.
Well, this handsome, dark stranger comes to visit the fishing village.
This is so funny, because the telenovelas, you know, they are very, very dramatic, and it's funny when she's like, oh, God, Mom. Like, I have relatives who sit there and watch these soap operas and really get into them, you know? They tune in every day just to see what happens, you know? And it's so funny that this is, like, a big part of the mom's life. And then Anna, who's just disgusted, again, by the whole cultural. Let me guess, Mom, she gets pregnant. Like, the typical story. And she's trying as hard as she can to not be that typical story. This is such a funny scene. I love this scene.
Look at Ingrid's expression.
Look, everybody's laughing. Everybody's having fun. This looks like a scene out of my house, where, like, we all sit around and we just talk. And, like, I'm the youngest of six kids. And we've all been there, and my mom, and we're talking about something, and we're enjoying each other's presence. There's no fight. I mean, there's still tension. You feel the tension in the scene between the mother still saying, Anna, that's what happens when you don't, listen to your mom.
Anna, you better listen. That's what happens to people who don't listen to their mothers. Okay. And all you had was the headless body.
Chances are there's the schools around her neighborhood are just filled with young, pregnant girls who will probably never graduate from high school. And if they do graduate from high school, grab a minimum wage job. And she sees that they probably don't even teach college. They don't talk about going to college. They don't have classes about how to apply to college, how to get into college. Whereas, in Beverly Hills High School, that's what they do. You have whole courses on your senior year, your junior year, on how to apply to college, how to write an essay, how to get into college. And Anna knows that. And she looks around at the schools where people are just there to go through the motions and get out as fast as they can, and said, this isn't this isn't where what I want to do. This isn't where I want to be.
Ironically, even your own counselors, the counselors that are in the diverse schools, will not support the student. That you want to go to college? No, I'll send you to beauty school.
Can I tell you something? My okay, this is the thing. Like going, all of my siblings are in college, all of us. But we were, you know, we're Hispanic, we're Latin, we're great public schools our whole lives. But if you're Hispanic or Black, you're automatically assumed to be bussed in from East LA. You know, just automatically. And we always lived in the valley. We always lived in the suburban, you know, area. And my sister was with college counselor, and the college counselor, she's like, I want to apply to Stanford. And the college counselor said, don't waste your time because you won't get in. They're not looking for you. So not even a lack of encouragement, but discouragement on top of it, of saying, don't even bother. And to me, too, when I was young, when I was a freshman, and I was always a great student, I graduated like a valedictorian, whatever. I had to prove myself 10 times over any other student because of, you know, they look at me and they automatically assume Hispanic girl from East LA. She doesn't even care about going to a four-year college. And I graduated a valedictorian in my class. And I had teachers and counselors who, they're like, AP classes? What are you wasting your time doing AP classes for? You know, just get it over with and get onto your minimum wage job. And there really is that lack of attention. They want to move on to the kids who, you know, the kids whose parents have money, you know, to send them off to four-year colleges. So going to public schools my whole life, it's a really harsh reality that counselors pick and choose who they choose to encourage. And it's usually the kids who need the least encouragement, you know, and the ones who need the encouragement.
But it's, you know, In her case, it's high school. In my case, it was a career, an outrageous career like this that everybody considered that I was crazy. She wants to be in it, please. You know, it's like my mother was the only support system I had to continue on and on and on as long as I've been doing it now. But again, it's the same thing. You don't get any encouragement at all. And producers, the powers that be, don't look at you that way. That's why you end up doing the kind of roles that I've had to do for so many years. But it's the same concept. Discouragement. I've seen a lot of my friends fall by the wayside. You know, you even think about the possibility that Ingrid, the sister, could be a designer. That there would have been some hope, or that even the sister herself would have said, I'm going to go to design school, to the fashion design school here in LA, to become a designer. There's that lack, I think, of dreams.
There's also, I think, culturally, there's a lack of confidence, just in the whole entire culture. I think that it's an epidemic. It really is, just in general, in every, we're not bred to be
leaders, self-motivated.
And it's not everybody. Some people watch this movie and say, that's not what my mom was like, or that's not what my grandma was like. Well, we're not saying that every Hispanic person is like this. Because I had a mother, you know, education wasn't an option. It was, you were going to college and that was it. It wasn't, oh, would you like to go to college? I was going, you know, and as I understand, same with Lupe. Her mother
was non-educated and there was no choice for me. I had to take it all the way. I had no choice.
Yeah.
And when in my family, like in her family, her siblings now have all finished. And in my family, they've finished also. Mm-hmm. So it's not, I don't know, it's just, I would say whatever, financial income matters a great deal because it's a question of survival. That comes first. Food on the table comes first.
Stella, if you don't pay me, how am I going to save up any money?
For what?
Forget it.
Ay, Anna, you're so selfish.
You expect me to do this dirty work for nothing?
This is dirty work?
Wanting to go to college, becoming more educated. She's very into the political aspect of
social.
Of this is social, political.
The feminine, the sexuality.
Yeah, and Josefina Lopez, the writer. It's semi-autobiographical. Of her life, and she is a very political person, and talking to her the few times that I did and getting to know her, I mean, this character just, it seemed natural that she would be passionate about anything that she talked about, because that's how Josefina is. She has an idea, and whether it's wrong or it's right, she sticks to it, because she's very political. See here, Anna's just She just doesn't understand this world. How can you work and work and work and get nothing and be okay with it? That's what, and you know the scene where she's like, they only pay you $18 and then they sell them for $600? You know, to anybody, it's like something should click in your head and you should do something about it.
But see, this is America. And if you look at this sweatshop and transfer it to any part of the world, in some parts they use children for this slave labor, because that's exactly what it is. It's exploitation to the max. And let's analyze this country. How many times have we been guilty of the very same thing? But we never seem to really care or mind, as long as it doesn't affect us. One of the few places, as a matter of fact, the only place I've ever been fired from was from a fast food restaurant where I just happened to organize the workers in there, and somebody didn't like it, so they got rid of me, but fast. Why do they hire nothing but teenagers? Because they're going to pay a minimum wage.
Actually, times where I went to the director, I said, Patricia, I have a feeling that people are going to hate this girl. Like, I don't like her. Jesus, like, she's never smiling. Look at her. She's just miserable. She hates everything. That's why I'm happy for the few scenes where with the grandpa and with the boyfriend and with the teacher, where she can be more lighthearted and have more fun. But, yeah, I mean, for the majority, I went to Patricia, and I was afraid that no one was going to like her. And she said, no, don't worry about it. You'll end up liking her.
In this scene, I used to have an aunt that was very much like I am in this film, the funny part of her. She could get away with anything. But in this scene, I kind of feel sorry for this woman. I truly do. Because of her ignorance, let us say, or limited education pertaining to her own the process of her body transformation as you get older, and that, I mean, it's funny, the people that are sitting here listening, but how many women that are that age that are sitting there in that audience that are Latino or otherwise can identify with it, because they don't know what's going on in their bodies, you know? And they laugh, the people that know better laugh at her and say, my God, how ignorant, you know, but...
This is another one of my favorite scenes.
But that's her.
There's just these little... Not one word is spoken in the whole thing. Look at the mom. She's just so fed up with it. And it's just like, Mom, you are out of control. I don't even get you. She's given up.
Why did Norma and the others have to leave?
That doesn't look that bad.
It is. You're not going to believe this. I heard gossip.
This is sad. This is really sad. This part where she, you know, Norma, the one who goes away to marry the man and take her kids.
With all her hopes and ambitions. And then
all invested in that man.
Yeah.
You know, and then it didn't work out. And God knows what she's doing now, working at another sweatshop.
See, she never really wants to be a part of them. She's always isolated. She also works aside from them. See, she's isolated with a steam iron over there.
She just watches, you know, and if she's compelled to say something, she'll say something. But she never wants to sit among them, be one of them.
And be a part of their gossip.
Yeah, she's disgusted with these women. Ugh. And what's funny is, I was with we had an interview with a reporter, and she said something really interesting, that this movie takes feminism in a completely different way. It's not women versus men feminism. This is women versus women feminism. The scene where they're talking about virginity and a woman should be a virgin, you know, there's that percentage of women who want, you know, the advancement of women for us to be equal to men. But then there's also that same percentage of women who don't care about being advanced.
That's right.
We think, you know, traditionally and culturally, yes, we should be virgins till we get married. No, we shouldn't have, you know, premarital sex. We should be wives and mothers and that's it. Like, that's, you know, and then it's a generational and a cultural thing where this girl, she has a very American political now, you know, mindset of women should be equal to men professionally, intellectually, spiritually. And then you have this mother, just a couple decades older, who's saying, why? What's the point? We should cook and clean and do laundry and work just to survive, and we should be happy with that. You know, so I think that there's a lot of political issues. The idea about contraceptives.
I think you deal with it in the couple of scenes as they come up where she deals with her
virginity,
her sexuality, and how the relationship with the young man. In this scene, are you afraid of her? She's saying, look at the expression Ingrid has, that she's not afraid, she's intimidated by her. But not afraid of her. Is afraid to speak up, maybe. But once you see, and she encourages her to speak out. But when the time comes, when they do confront the lady in this scene here, look at the way Ingrid walks into the scene is just telling you she doesn't want to, she'd rather die than be there. And when she's told she needs an appointment, well, thank you very much, but let's go. I don't want to hassle this.
Yeah, Anna is so proud. She has so much pride, which is a good thing. But then in the scene,
You
see that she isn't the smartest.
Right,
you
right.
Know,
she just opened her mouth at the wrong
girl,
time.
But she has a lot to learn. She's only 18, and she thinks she knows it all, which could be a great quality in a world where really you're the only person who believes in you. You know, that's why she gets as far as she does. But you see in the scene, she thinks that, we need money. Give us money because we need it, and because we want it, and because you should. You know? And she thinks that that's going to do the trick. And then she gets shot down. She's like, who are you? Like, So you see that there is validity to why Estella is the way she is. Why is she so? Because she's faced rejection her whole life. Because she knows the reality of it. And you see this freshness and motivation and enthusiasm in Anna for life because she hasn't faced that type of rejection in her life yet.
Yeah. You have to help yourself and meet your deadlines. You have until the end of the month. That's when the order has to be shipped. You have 10 days, honey. 10 days. That's it.
Once the woman puts her in her place, she's got egg on her face and says, well, that didn't work, did it? But you almost lost your contract, see?
Yeah. See, there should be, you know, that motivation that Anna has, that her spirit hasn't been broken yet, you know? And then you look at Estella, and that's Anna 20 years from now. You know, Anna's spirit broken, afraid to go ahead in the world because all she knows is rejection, you know? And the thing is that Estella has submitted herself to that. Okay, I'll just keep my place. Where you see Anna won't do that. We fast forward 20 years, and Anna won't be someone's assistant. She will be the boss.
Tu mamá está preguntando por ti, mija.
Ana!
Oye, Ana, tu mamá está un poco zafada, ¿eh?
You're just figuring this out?
Estás preguntando por su niñita. ¿Qué sabe que tendrá?
Buenas.
Buenas.
This idea of the cousins being there is so real because I grew up with my cousins, and it wasn't even like, it was us six and then my two cousins. We're just part of the family. So it's very
It was
extensive.
Always lending a helping hand to the extended family.
Yeah, it's not
about... You just don't turn your back to your family.
Right.
Ana, be serious. Comfort me.
Mom, did you ever think that maybe you're not pregnant and you're just imagining all of this?
I am pregnant.
This was never in the play. None of this that she... I don't remember that she was pregnant, but not as detailed as it is here.
See, and then Anna just constantly giving it back to her.
See, they're so much alike, though.
But I think
this
Anna
is the
knows.
Wonder of it all.
Anna knows. She says, Mom, you're trying to manipulate me. Why are you telling me? If you're so concerned about being pregnant, go to the doctor. Don't come to me. And she hates it because she's trying to find a way to manipulate Anna, and Anna sees right through it. This is cute. You know, also this idea of an 18-year-old not allowed to go out with a boy, you know? 18 and see, graduated from high school, isn't allowed to date. It's so funny.
Se me hace muy buena idea.
Bye, Dad.
No nos esperen.
Que se diviertan, eh?
Gracias, buenas noches.
Thank you.
vemos en 2 horas.
Pórtase bien.
Yo también.
She's in absolute control there in her sexuality. Exactly. The purpose that she has.
How girls are, they're just expected to just be cute and don't say anything wrong and just make the guy like you.
I think it's very apropos to the times, you know, because smart girls who are like Anna. I'm not talking about the girls who have no idea what sex is, have no concept, would not have this kind of dialogue. You know what I'm saying? They do, but because she's being seductive, see, obviously.
Yes.
She's got one track mind there. But it's being done in a very, how can I say, dramatic kind of way.
I think she also does a lot of hiding of her emotions through laughing at herself. I think it's something that a lot of people do when you're insecure.
Let me ask you, did you feel heavy? I mean,
did I ever feel heavy? No.
Yeah. No.
I've never felt
heavy.
Like I'm overweight or I'm fat or I'm obese or I'm unlikable. I always, you know, during the filming, I always felt very normal. I never felt, abnormal. I thought, okay, I'm a girl that guys could like. But, I don't know. The thing with this boyfriend, it's like, she hides a lot of her insecurity from him. He doesn't want her to know that she doesn't like her body and she doesn't like who she, you know, she doesn't like herself physically. And I don't think she does. I don't think.
She says to him later in the scene, after they've had sex or prior to having sex.
This is who I, turn on the lights. I want you to see.
I want you to see
this is
who I
am.
Right there, it tells you.
But it feels like it's the first time she's ever looked at herself. Like, this is who I am. Is it for him? You know, she almost forgets that he's there. It's like, this is me. This is the first time she's looked at herself. And the fact that she's had sex with somebody and that he was attracted to her and liked her, you know, it made it easier for her to like herself, I think.
I guess this is good night.
This is a sort of a traditional bit of a ceremony and the anniversary of someone you love. It's an altar that is set up in their memory, celebrating their life. Most of the time there's an altar, the celebration of the Day of the Dead in November, November the 2nd, which is a joyous kind of celebration.
Yes.
But here, she's created an altar to memorialize him in her own way. She serves the rum or the you know, the liquor, because that's
so
what he liked.
Handsome.
It doesn't mean she's going to drink it. And you put it up because you hope that he will come to drink it.
It's like taking flowers to a grave.
Except she's just doing it at work. She would probably go to the grave also and take flowers over there.
You know what's frightening about this? About, you know, this story she tells about her father being dead and her... I had a friend who came to watch this movie, and she said that part made me break down in tears. I said, why? She said it was the same thing with her uncle. Her uncle was almost dead, but they didn't have money to pay, like, the hospital bill, so she got him, took him in a cab, and he died at home. And and some people watch this, they're like, how ridiculous. That's such an unrealistic story. And then there are those people who relate almost 100%, you know? So scary.
And like I said, there were a lot of scenes where Patricia and Josefina and the writers allowed us to make changes in the dialogue that we felt like, I said, this is the way that I would talk, and this is what I would say, but not to take away from the meaning, the original intention of the dialogue. But that, I think, contributed a great deal. I know that Anna made some changes there.
Yeah, definitely.
And so did Soledad when she was talking about how she would have taken her father out.
Anita, what are you doing here?
Papi, I need some help.
I told Estela this many times. If you do not have the cash up front, do not.
Just hear, like, I think that's so interesting that usually in film, when they're talking about the stereotypical Latino family, the men are shown as a very macho, you know, strong men. And the women are the more obedient, you know, subservient type of people. And in this film, it's so different, where the women are very dominant. And you see the scene where the father to Anna, the father is the only tender part of, you know, of her parents that she can approach. So she approaches her father, and he's very caring and of her.
Miña Maconia, miña torcida, miña querida, miña galera. Oh, miña cachoeira, miña menina, miña flamenga, miña capoeira. Oh, miña menina, miña querida, miña valera. Oh, miña maloca, miña la rica, miña cachaça, miña cadeira.
A lot of people ask why they never hear, you know, what's in her essay. And I agree, I really wish that there was, you know, that either a voiceover of her reading the essay or somehow find out what she, you know, wrote. And I agree with that. You just see the scenes of her writing it and then turning it in. And I think, you know, just my own input, if we were to hear that essay as the character, I think what she would have written about is the factory.
She did, in the play.
Oh, she did? See, I've never even seen or read
it. It was like a narrative of hers at the beginning of the play. She would go into the restroom and she would write and she would read out loud.
Oh, see, I've never seen or read the play, so I don't know that. But just that's interesting. But as a character, I think that she would write about the factory and about what she learned that summer, and that change in her, you know, from her perspective of what true dignity is, or what real work is, or what really matters in life. And I think that's what her essay would have been about, even though you never hear about it. And it's unfortunate that we don't hear about it, but then again, like so many other things in the film, it leaves a lot for the audience to think, you know? Of what do you think she would have written about, so.
So maybe we can turn on a fan in here.
Fan blows dust on the dresses. Can you iron it a little faster? I need help with the hems, and we're never gonna make the deadline.
Estela, okay? It's not that I don't iron fast enough. That every time I finish ironing, I stop for a minute. I mean, to really look at the dress. I never realized how much work, puro lomo, as Mom says, is put into it.
And then look at you see in this scene, you really see another side of Anna where you're starting to see her defenses break down, where you see a little bit more of, she does think about what's going on in the factory. And she does relate in a way. She's saying, I would want nothing more than to be able to wear this dress. And it's not, you know, literally I want to wear this piece of clothing. More of that sense of
wishful thinking.
Of pride or I would like to wear something that wasn't intended for me. You know, I would like to be educated, although it wasn't intended for me to be educated. I would like to live a middle-class life, even though I was born into a working-class society, you know? So I think that's what that signifies. When they're walking down the street, you know? It's just another... Her mother just wants to control every aspect of her life, even by the way she walks. I want you to walk the way I walk, you know?
You know, if I remember, my mother used to be like that. She used to correct me, let us say. She used to say to me, it's so wonderful to be nice to people. So wonderful when a woman can fit in just about any environment. So Be nice to people. It's wonderful for a woman to be popular, to be accepted everywhere she goes, you know. She never taught me how to embroider and nothing like that. It was never like that. She said, you're going to college and you're going to make something of yourself. And I did. You know, I ended up with college and, you know, psychologist and all that. But she used to say, camina bien, put your shoulders back. Because I was developing too fast when I was 12 and 13. And I would hide because I was self-conscious. You know, and she would say, be proud and put your shoulders back. And like she's telling you, walk like a lady. I just remember that. When she finally tells him and asks him if he's going through the same thing she is as a kid, that's what she asks.
She's trying to figure out if she's the only one in the world who feels the way she does, you know? Trying to ask somebody else, like, what's it like in your house, you know? Am I crazy? Am I the only person who deals with this type of stuff, you know? And I think that's one of the reasons why people love watching movies about reality, because you feel like there's someone else in the world who's experienced what you've experienced. You know what I mean? Like, you're not alone. And sometimes we can get so caught up in the eye of life that you forget that. You forget that a lot of people go through the same thing you go through, you know? But
And most teenagers feel they're the only ones in the world that are suffering.
Yeah, yeah. But Brian was great working with him. We, you know, from the beginning, we hit it off. We had a good relationship. And you know, he's a teenager. I was a teenager. There's always sexual tension when teenagers are, you know, and we fought sometimes. There's scenes where we're like holding hands and we were like, we skipped the scene, I think. But we're supposed to, like, be having a great time, and we were so mad at each other. We were fighting about something. I don't know. It's funny. But he was great. We got a really great. He was so sweet in this part, you know. I think all the men in this movie are portrayed as very gentle, you know, sweet people.
Yeah, real people.
Yeah. This is a great scene, and everybody asks about the red dress.
Why didn't you wear the red dress?
You know.
Well, we did. Remember?
We did. We did that scene
in the fashion show.
And it's gonna be on the DVD too. The edited scene.
The question will be answered.
She did, but I think that we filmed the fashion show. She comes back after college, and Estella has made her own line of clothing, and they're modeling this fashion show, and Anna comes out in the red dress, looking, you know, all grown up and beautiful. And I think what the producers thought was that it just didn't belong in the movie. The director, and they'll explain why. But I think that they wanted it to be more realistic. And I think that I like
there's a reconciliation with the mother, the whole thing. It's just too syrupy and
it's
too perfect.
It's too Hollywood ending, you know.
What do you want?
Senora, can I please speak to your daughter?
No, she's not here.
This choice I made right on the spur of the moment. No, she's not here. And when she turns around, she says, it's that man that's always looking for Anna. I mean, she turns it around. She doesn't like this guy coming around. What does this guy want with my daughter? Yeah, he can pretend to be a teacher, and he can pretend. Now, what exactly is your relationship with her, with him? You know, a mother would question that. You know what I'm saying?
This scene for me was really... It took a lot of emotional range, I guess, because she had to be so happy, so ecstatic. Like, she's almost like, I can't believe we did this. And then in the next instant, her mother brings her back to reality. You know, she's like, don't go too far in your happy land. She's like, I don't think so. You still have...
Now what do I do, she says.
Yeah, so she just doesn't believe it. Like, what else? You didn't help me, so I did it myself. I got in, and you're not going to let me go? Like, I did this on my own. I worked so hard to get in. I got in, and now you're going to tell me that I can't have it? But her mother's so manipulative. You know, the way she brings in the grandpa, says, what about your grandpa? Because she knows that that's the one thing that Anna, you know... We're a family, she says.
You also have a woman that's quite stubborn. You know, we're going to pick up on that later as She leaves, you know, the stubbornness. How many of us have made mistakes and are just too proud or too stubborn to admit we're wrong? I mean, this mother's not perfect, because if this mother was perfect, we wouldn't have a film here. You know what I'm saying? You'd have a very predictable kind of, you wouldn't have the relationship.
I think what I recognized right off the bat when I read the script was that it was nothing out of the ordinary. You know, these are all feelings that everybody has felt at one point in their life. And you know, you feel aggravated, you feel, you know, deflated, unappreciated, you feel hopeful. I mean, these aren't things that, they're not asking me to be, you know, a psycho killer or a bipolar, you know, these are just real emotions. So to me, I didn't feel, I'm not a very good actor. I cannot act like I'm sad. I cannot act like I'm happy. I can make myself happy and I can make myself sad and then say lines. You know, so when I look sad in this, it's because inside I was sad at that moment. I wasn't acting like I was sad. So as an actor, I try to make myself sad at that moment. You know, I'm not really happy and acting like I'm sad, because I can't cry on cue. You tell me to cry, I can't do it. But if you say make yourself sad, I can make myself sad and then cry, and then the tears.
You know what it is? It comes down being in control of your emotions. And knowing those emotions and to be able to press those buttons that make them go, you know, that's where the key is. Mm-hmm. Like those soda fountains, you press the Coke and you press the Sprite and you press whatever. And here you get to a point after, like, for myself, after so many years, she will eventually cry on cue. You know, all she needs is to have to do it enough times. But it's just being very much in control. And a lot of actors are not in control of their emotions. That's why they have to bring in technique. When your own original emotion does not work, then you bring in a technique that will work, that you know. And a lot of times it may not be the right technique to get the right reaction at this instant, at this moment, with this film or whatever. You know what I'm saying? She was just very much in control, and the choices she made emotionally were very much in tune with the character. Had she made the wrong choices, we would have had a very different character. I met a woman from Kenya in Washington, D.C. Recently, and she adores this scene where this girl goes, because of the situation in Africa with AIDS and what have you, and she says, this film should go to my country. And in particular, because of how this young girl takes the initiative to go and take that, buy it, and then apply it when the situation arises. But then too, you have a young man, this young man, who responds to her request. Not, that's not always the case. You know what I'm saying? And these are thoughts to be reckoned with. The different cultures, males are males and females are females, but, you know, for the sake of saving, you know, your life.
She makes a conscious decision, I think, in her own mind, say, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to have sex. She goes out. She buys the condom. She says, let's do it. And in the end, she says, don't worry about me, I'm going to be okay. And it's not the typical story of the girl being the victim of a broken heart and he didn't love me or he didn't call me. She's being very realistic about it. And she does it, I think, for self-discovery. You know, this is what I have to do for myself. You know, not for him, not because I feel pressured, but because it's a part of life that she wanted to delve into. And he happened to be there and she said, you know, let's go for it. And I think
the lights on.
There was a lot of independence in the way that she handles, you know, that sexual. Because in tons of movies, you see the losing of the virginity and how the girls are always shown as the victims, you know, kind of rape, of, you know, wanting it to be love, wanting it to be magical, you know. And this is a very realistic point of view of her saying, I don't need all that. You know, I just want to grow up. I just want to experience this part of life. And I think that's the the difference between her and her mom, because her mom thinks that it should be with the man you love and it should be magical and it should, you know, it should be a huge deal. And that's another generational conflict. Where in these times, it's like, you know, you turn on MTV and people are having sex, you know, it doesn't, it's not even a big deal anymore. It's lost that enchantment, I guess, of what sex should be in our times, I think, in my generation. It's another very political thing, you know. Everybody has their own idea about premarital sex. It can be a religious thing, a political thing, or whatever. But it's another, I think everything she does is to make a statement, I think to make a point, if to nobody else, for herself, you know? To say the first time I had sex, it was my choice, and it wasn't on prom night, and it wasn't with the love of my life, you know? It was just, it was what it was. And you see the guy wanting to get more attached than she does, you know? She's more like, you know what? Don't worry about me, I'm gonna be okay. And you can tell that she likes him. It's not that she's saying, I don't care about you. It's more her being real about what, you know, what's going on, and which is the complete opposite of what her mother does. And she tries so hard to be not like her mom that in some ways she's exactly like her mom.
How moms know, how my mom could tell when my aunt was pregnant out of wedlock, I'll never know. To this day, I can't tell when somebody, but mothers have a way of just this intuition.
This is like Anna really standing up to her mom.
You would say that, wouldn't you?
See, and so far she's humored her mom. Okay, mom, you're pregnant. Go see a doctor. Okay, mom. And here she says, no, mom, you're not pregnant. Let me tell you what's wrong. You are pretending because you want me to be here, and I know you're manipulating me.
Me embarrass you? Know?
And then this confirms it. This scene.
I am pregnant.
You're not pregnant.
Yes, I am.
You're not pregnant, mom. You're only pretending you're pregnant because you want a baby in the house. You can't have a baby. I'm not your baby anymore.
No, señora, you're not pregnant.
Of course I am.
Doña Carmen, don't you think
Pete Leal goes back, my goodness, we go back to the 70s in there. He's done several series. He's got a wonderful part in The American Family for PBS. I think it's about time. Excellent work that he does. He's always very, he's got this look like a sweet grandpa.
Mom, the doctor said no sugar.
Let's talk about this scene. We made up, this is our pride and joy.
Oh, this one we worked on.
We improv this scene. It was written in a very different way, and we were having trouble finding out why it was in the script. What does this mean? And that was the beauty, I think, of working with Lupe. We really played off of each other, and we experimented a lot. And we kind
this
of
one we rehearsed. This one that I can remember, we rehearsed because there was a waiting period there, and during before we shot it. So we were sitting there talking. Let's run the lines, and let's look for whatever we can find here and what have you. And sure enough,
that's like every scene. Every scene so far, like starting from you know, that scene where she slams the door in her mom's face, she gets more defiant with every scene. It's almost the sex, you know, when she makes the decision to have sex, something has been born in her, you know, something of, I can love myself. Someone else is capable of loving me. So why should, you know, because I think to this point she feels like her mother has made her feel like she will never be worth loving, you know? And unless you're skinny.
Unless you're skinny.
Perfect, unless you're beautiful, you're not worth it, you know? And once she found out, Mom, you're lying to me. If that was right, then why would this guy like me? Why would this guy sleep with me? Why would this guy want to be with me? You're lying. And she's mad at her, and now she's being as defiant as she possibly can. She stands up to her mom, slams the door in her face, eats the flan is the next scene. And then the next scene, which we'll see, where she, you know, does what her mother is disgusted with, takes off her clothes. She is, you know, she's getting very defiant with each scene. And it, of course, goes to the climax. But
what are you doing?
Hi, Mama. Come on. It's so hot. All the steam has me sweating like
this. Was a really hard scene for me to shoot. I was hesitant at first. And I mean, come on. If you were a 17-year-old girl or boy and they said you're going to strip for millions of people.
But she's America. She's a different kind of teenager. I mean, girls nowadays will strip for nothing. I mean, just blink an eye and they'll do it. They don't care. But she's a traditional Latina girl. Look at her.
I'm not very traditional. But
no, but you know what I'm talking about. But, and she walked in and I said, are you ready for the strip scene? She said, it's going to be a closed set. It's just the cameraman and myself.
No,
And then I said, yeah, right. I said, but 20 zillion people are going to be watching. And afterwards, she said, I hadn't thought about it that way. But then after she did it, she wouldn't stop.
That
she was
stop
having
taking
fun.
My clothes off. No, it was. It did turn fun.
My wife says to everybody, fuck you.
Yeah, there she goes, saying the F word. Yeah, it was. I had fun. Just like, this is the mutiny, you know. This is mutiny, Mom. I'm the captain of this ship now. Where usually, you know, the mom comes in and she's the head of the factory, and everybody listens intently when she has her stories to tell. And Anna just sits back and watches, and says, "How does my mom have so much damn control over people?" You know. And then here Anna is like, "It's time for mutiny." She takes over the ship. You know, she's got these women rallying and saying, "Look, Mom, my opinions have validity too." Lord Rosalie feels the same way. You know, look at her, and she feels like she's big. And here we go, competition. You want to see cellulite?
In the play, I go into the restroom in the shop, and then I come out, but I was wearing like a slip. I remember Josefina would strip down to like what she's wearing right there. And of course, there was one girl that had a fabulous figure, you can imagine. I don't know what she was doing in the shop anyway. She's the one that says, I'm too fat, whatever. But then we have a heavier set girl that was in the show. And I would come out and I would have no top on. But that's as far as it would get.
Yeah.
Pretty far.
Yeah, just the top.
I think that this is like, it's just like that moment where, you know, it's just like we don't care anymore.
Look how beautiful we are.
Que bien se siente, ¿verdad? To be rid of all these clothes and just let it all hang out. Okay, ladies, we have work to do. Come on.
Every time I watch this scene with 500 people sitting around me, I just think, like, what the hell was I thinking? Or why would I do this? My film debut and I'm going to be naked. I don't know. It was just, it is liberating. And I do look at myself in a very different way now, you know? And I was in my underwear on TV, but I wasn't meat. I wasn't exploiting sex. I wasn't doing anything disgusting. And I think when I see how women react to it, they embrace it and they love it, and they feel like it's about time. And when I feel like I've spoken for a lot of voices that never get heard, it's worth it. You know, it's worth the embarrassment. And then it turns into pride, you know, the fact that I could do that. You know, Jesus, who would have thought?
You stop to think about the horrendous thought that everybody should have a perfect body. That women have to be beautiful and men have to be muscular. And anybody in between, where do we go? You know, what are we supposed to do with ourselves? And we're only beautiful for a short time, you know, because youth is not forever. Muscle tone is not forever. And this is the pathetic part, is that this is us. You know, this is who we really are, as women or as men, because men have come up to her and talked about their overweight, right?
Yeah, like a 50-year-old white man, you know, was like, that was me, that was my story. I was like, you're not Mexican, 18, or a female, you know? And that's the thing, I really think this film really crashes those barriers, you know, about people think that an experience, you know, is particular, you know, specific to a culture, where I think the story about just loving yourself and appreciating who you are really, you know, supersedes those barriers and really transcends, you know, into lots of cultures.
Tell them about the scene, what people think.
Oh, they always think I'm pregnant. Yeah, people have told me, they're like,
and I watch it and I say, yeah, maybe. I thought that too.
Yeah, when people are like, when she's like, Dad, I have something to tell you. Mm-hmm. And she never says what it is. And he says, you have my blessing. Some people are like, oh, my God, is she pregnant? And it's so funny that people's minds
look at her face. See, her expression kind of says, whoops.
Some people think it's obvious that she's pregnant. You know, like, oh, my God, the condom didn't work. Or, oh, my God, you know, some people think, oh, she's going to college, and other people think she's pregnant. And I think it's just a testament for, you know, which
way. Well, because, see, I knew that Josefina went to school, so I knew what the answer was. See, I cheated. But when you're sitting there taken totally by surprise, yeah, it's a possibility.
That she could be.
But it's the most beautiful response she gets from her father. You have my blessing.
Ana tiene algo que decirte.
And then this scene where she's washing her face, you think she's having morning sickness or something. It really, people did think like, oh my God, she's pregnant. She's sick. But then it's great because it could go, you know, both ways. And thank God that, you know, for her, it went, this scene was like, can I tell you something? We didn't shoot this scene together. She did hers earlier in the morning, and they let her go, and I came in and did my part.
Right.
And we didn't have each other to work off of for the scene, which was okay, and I thought worked because I was talking to a door, you know? And that's the feeling. It is like, God, she's not listening to me.
Gotta go to the factory. I'm gonna do great. Call me, okay?
Anita.
Ya me voy, Eva.
Te vaya bien.
Okay.
Vámonos, hija. You're gonna be late. I'll wait for you in the truck.
Okay. What's so tough about this is that
you know, when I turned around like that is because I want to say I'm not hearing you. I'm not listening to you. I don't want to hear it.
You have to think, like, it took a lot.
Anna now what
had,
do I do?
Anna had
should
to,
I? Should I?
Anna had to swallow her pride to even come in and say, Mom, I want your blessing. Like, that took a lot of on her behalf. And you think that when you make something like that, that someone will come back and give you, okay, you have my blessing. She swallowed her pride and did this, and her damn mom won't even come out to say goodbye.
This is the unforgivable in the mind of the audience. Everybody comments about this.
Like, how could she not?
How could she even hesitate?
Mama, come on, open the door.
There is so much in-depth information that you get from her at different levels. You understand? It was quite, I wouldn't say that it was difficult to play because I've done little bits and pieces of this kind of a mother in so many films before. So it was an excellent opportunity to make a composite of all those women. You understand? And of course, I knew the play, I know the writer. Everything was very personal to me. When right now she's thinking about it, that she finally decides she might go and open the door. And right there, it's a matter of pride.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to go. She's offended me. She's been this. She's been, you know, mothers, how you hold grudges.
There was that moment.
Now, at this moment when I grab the picture is that, yeah, it's reaching my heart. Says my, I know she's leaving. I'm going to miss her, and that's why I took the picture in my hand, because I'm relating to that picture.
There was that moment that you saw when the father's like, you're going to, where the grandpa's like, you're going to miss your plane, where she gave her one last chance, and she's like, I'm doing it with or without you. And I think that's a very, very hard choice to make it so much easier said than done, because I know what it feels like to go against, you know, she loves her mom, and to go against and say, Mom, I'm doing it with or without you.
This was not written, and we decided to shoot that she would come out, but too late.
Too late.
Too late. You know, it's like everything in life, sometimes it's too late. And here, I didn't want to overdo it with the crying, but she is crying.
And then look,
but
Anna,
you just don't see it. And see?
Anna also, looking back, saying, did she run out? Did she want to say bye? No, she didn't. Okay, I'm moving on now. It's so sad because it's like they both want to so bad.
They're stubborn.
Reconcile, but they're both stubborn. Both of them. Anna's just like her mom. And then here, like, you know, the father and the grandpa just being kind of that little bit of support that she did have at home, you know, and having to say goodbye, you know. It's so hard, but everybody has to do it at one point, you know, just go.
Cuídate mucho, hijita.
I think I would be interested to see how it goes for her over there, what her experiences are, if she keeps writing or she begins to write her stories about her life or whatever, how she relates to New York, how she relates to that culture over there, how she begins to mature. I would like to see the family dealing without Anna.
But I think this right here, this is the scene where you know she's gonna be okay. You know, like, I think New York is a very scary place. Like, you know, being alone and saying, I'm here alone, it's scary. And yet you see she can hold her own. And then here's the walk you were talking about, where it's like a play off that previous walk. But she's remembering, you know? Like, I'm remembering where
I've been. And as a parent, you stop to think, because America doesn't have any children, but it is scary to have your 17-year-old or your 18-year-old or your 19-year-old go to a scary place like that. But there's only one way they're gonna find out, and that's to experience it. My kids went off.
And then I love this part where she looks left and then she looks right.
Which way am I going?
Right, hold on, at the very end. She looks and she decides where she's gonna go. Like, it's very fast, but she makes that decision and she goes.
Shots of East LA are so beautiful, you know?
You don't generally get to, you know, see, when they show LA, they show Hollywood and Beverly Hills and Malibu. They never show, like, you know, where the majority.
Life in the raw. Like,
you know, the body
with all its color and its culture, whatever. Whether you're down in the Vietnamese community or you're down whatever culture, you know.
All those. There's me. My name. I was very excited when I saw my name for the first time.
Otra vez?
Short. She's like,
I know a lot of songs.
She's 4 feet tall.
What? What do you want me to say? Otra vez.
This was so, I love this.
Look at her. She's the heart of this ending, no?
Just another part of life, a little piece of life.
Quiero agradecerle a todo el público, hablo hispano, por su atención, por su apoyo para esta película y esperemos que el futuro nos traiga mejor vida para todos, para nuestros hijos y para nuestras familias. Gracias.
Gracias a todos para compartir estos tiempos con nosotros y besos a todos y nos vemos en la teatras. No, that's not even a word. Okay. Nos vemos in the movies. How do you say movies?
En las películas. En
like
la pantalla.
Movie theaters. Oh, nos vemos en la pantalla.
Nos vemos en los teatros.
Okay, nos vemos en los teatros. Okay. Besos a todos y nos vemos en los teatros.